This program aims to find solutions to your medical queries. It seeks answers to common health problems that have been hounding you. We will help you out in finding answers to your medical concerns. Good evening, everyone. I'm Angel Jacob, and this is MedTalk, your weekly on-air health consultation here on 9TV.
The numbers are rising, particularly in the 15 to 24 age group. Today, teenagers as young as 15 years old are reportedly suffering from HIV-AIDS. According to the Philippine HIV-AIDS Registry, there were 118 cases of new HIV patients in January of this year alone.
High school pa lang, we have cases na HIV positive na sila. So the trend now is getting younger. Mas pabata ng pabata na ang nakakuha ng sakit ng HIV.
By the end of the year, the number of HIV-AIDS cases is expected to reach more than 30,000, with 16 cases recorded on a daily basis, based on data gathered from the Department of Health.
Sa katunayan, noong September 2014, above 500 cases per month ang na-detect. Ito yung highest so far na na-detect na number of cases na positive for HIV. About 16 Filipinos are getting HIV in a day, or 2 Filipinos getting infected with the virus every hour. So ganun na ang problema natin sa sakit na HIV-AIDS.
AIDS is a disease caused by a virus named Human Immunodeficiency Virus, or HIV. It hinders your immune system from doing its job, making you more susceptible to other diseases and infections.
Once the virus entered the body of a person, inside, it's like war or battle, no? Dumadami ang virus sa loob ng katawan. There will come a time na sa sobrang dami na ng virus, ng HIV sa loob ng katawan ng tao, ito ay hindi na nakakayanan ng labanan ng resistensya ng tao. So we call it opportunistic infection.
It can be transmitted in various ways, such as blood transfusion, oral, vaginal or anal sex, and even contaminated needles. And while there is no known cure for this major global public health issue, there are now treatments that can slow down the progress of this disease.
The medicines that we have right now are called antiretrovirals. These antiretrovirals are not cure. When we say cure, complete resolving of the disease. It's the action of these antiretrovirals available right now. It just slows down the replication or the multiplication of the virus.
What is the difference between HIV and AIDS? What is the connection between HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases? Find out the answers tonight on MedTalk.
And joining us tonight is Dr. Kate Leiritana, Medical Director of Sustained Health Initiatives of the Philippines, and she's a member of the Philippine Society for Microbiology and Infectious Diseases. Also with us tonight is Dr. Mark Pasayan, an infectious disease specialist at the Research Institute for Tropical Medicine AIDS Research Group. You may join in the discussion by calling our hotline at 548-4678. Good evening, Dr. Kate.
Good evening, Angel.
Welcome to MedTalk. December 1 is fast approaching. December 1 is World AIDS Day.
Yeah.
How big of a concern is AIDS in the country and worldwide? Let's start with Dr. Kate.
Worldwide, HIV has infected around 35.3 million people. And although the numbers are trending downwards, we have less and less infection in the other parts of the world. Unfortunately, in the Philippines, we are one of the 11 countries which has a greater than 25% increase in our incidence.
Okay, increase in our incidence in the last how many years is this?
It's 10 years. That's from 2001 to 2011. Yeah. The Philippines is one of the 11 countries with increasing number of new cases of HIV.
That's not a good. That's not good information. To share, so to speak. But why is it increasing? Why hasn't it declined with the advent of modern medicine, sophisticated technology?
Well, for one, a lot of people get tested now. There are a lot of test centers. So that explains a lot of numbers also. Mm. But we cannot also forget the fact that, you know, there is also an increasing infection among our certain population.
Mm-hmm. It's part of it is the increased numbers come about from increased awareness, so people moving forward, getting themselves tested. Mm-hmm. That's why we get new diagnoses. But also, we have to take into consideration that there is a change in behavior.
Okay.
Primarily, HIV is transmitted sexually. Mm-hmm. So more and more people are having risky behaviors, mm-hmm. Not practicing safe sex, so that is one way for them to get infected. Right now, there is a decrease in safe practices, such as condom use, mm-hmm. Among sexually active people. And for those who engage in injecting drug use, mm-hmm. sometimes people share needles, and that is one way also for people to transmit the virus.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned people, the mm-hmm. age group 15 to 24.
Right.
That's quite disturbing.
It is disturbing because it's the young professionals, people in college, just finished college. But then this is also the age group wherein people would like to explore.
Yes.
And like what Dr. Aitan said, the number one mode of transmission of HIV is sexual contact. Mm-hmm. So it's actually more of a behavioral risk that's we're dealing with here. And it is very alarming, really, that it is the group of people that's having had high number of HIV now in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Doctors, enlighten us on what causes HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus. Dr. Kate.
So HIV, as you said, Angel, is the human immunodeficiency virus. It is a retrovirus. It is a, compared to the other viruses
yes.
We talked about earlier, it is a smart virus in a way that it knows how to evade the immune system. So our body, to defend itself against pathogens or infections in the environment, has its own set of defense. That's what we call the immune system. HIV knows how to move around the body in order not to get itself killed by the immune system. It can easily mutate, it's genetically very diverse, and it can find reservoirs or hiding places, making it latent. Therefore, up to now, we still don't have a cure for it.
Okay, so it finds an area in your body
right.
where the doctors cannot find it as well.
Nor the medicine.
The medicine can act on, that's why, to get rid of it. So it goes in a latent stage inside your body. Mm-hmm. So it evades your immune system. And the medicines that are available are not effective for these latent viruses in your body.
Mm-hmm. Unlike the flu virus or dengue, there's a cure for that.
Yes.
And you can easily diagnose that kind of disease. This one, hindi talaga. Kayo yung tinatakasan instead of the virus being able to escape the body. And with this virus, no, I'm sure a lot of our viewers would like to know, where is it from? Where do we get this virus? How do people contract this virus?
There are a lot of hypotheses. They say that it came from monkeys.
That was the information passed on
sometime
in the 80s.
Because in all the pathogens of all infectious diseases, there's always a cycle of the host, environment, and humans and animals. And the HIV is one of them. Mm-hmm. And they say it's actually from a spillover from some viruses that infects other animals. Mm-hmm. And that's how they find HIV.
Mm-hmm. This is the information passed on by the scientists in, I mentioned earlier, no? In the 80s, when we first learned of HIV.
Yep.
What is the difference between HIV and AIDS? Because when you say HIV, mm-hmm. it's closely linked to AIDS, of course.
Okay, so you can say that a person has HIV once that person is infected with a virus. that is a disease state. Now, when HIV goes through the natural course of the disease, it will eventually decrease your immune capacity to defend yourself against opportunistic infections. Mm-hmm. And throughout time, once left untreated, it can complicate and then progress into full-blown AIDS or acquired immune deficiency syndrome. Mm-hmm.
So, is it are all those who are diagnosed with HIV, if left untreated, as you've mentioned, will progress into full-blown AIDS? Does this happen all the time?
It is the course of the disease, of the infection, that mm-hmm. eventually, while the number of the virus inside the body increases, your immune system will go down, and you'll progress into that stage called AIDS. Mm-hmm. But there's a small percentage of HIV patients that will have a more prolonged course. But for all patients with HIV, eventually, when the immune system is very compromised and the viral load inside the body is very high, it will progress to AIDS if the patient is not treated or started on treatment. Mm-hmm.
So before we move into or go into treatment, what kind of contacts result in transmission of the virus? Is this a handshake? Is this by hugging? What kind of transmission?
Well, the number one mode of transmission is still sexual contact. And when we say sexual contact, it involves anal sex, vaginal sex, and oral sex. Mm. Then other modes of transmission would be sharing needles, intravenous drug use. There's also reports on mother-to-child transmission, mm-hmm. And also reports on those receiving blood transfusion. Okay. That are blood products that are infected with HIV.
But there's screening for blood transfusion.
Yes, now there
and,
is. It's required.
Donation of other organs of the body.
Well. Yes.
So you have to be screened first before you can donate. How about the virus being transmitted, non-transmission of the virus, aside from what you've mentioned?
Okay, so a lot of people are afraid that if in the same room with a person living with HIV, that they may get the virus from a simple cough, mm-hmm. holding one's hand, or hugging. Now, these are myths. As Dr. Pasayan said, the four modes of transmission are sex, mother to child, and then blood. Holding someone's hand, hugging, and then sharing utensils with food, sharing the toilet, these are not modes of transmission documented by medical literature to transmit HIV.
Okay. So it's good that we're clearing that up, because mm-hmm. a lot of people still have that in mind, that when you kiss or you hug mm-hmm. or share utensils.
Yes.
How come that people think that by sharing utensils you can get this virus?
Maybe they like it to other diseases which can do that, like for example hepatitis.
Yes.
Yeah, you can do that.
Mm-hmm. And for one thing, you don't get HIV from mosquitoes.
Yes,
that's
also
a very common question. Can you get that from mosquitoes, from other animals? No. Mm-hmm. That's why it's called HIV. It's human. It's a human infection.
Okay, so nothing from a mosquito. Yep. It's not airborne.
It's not airborne.
Not from the water.
No. It's not from water.
From sharing utensils. So much information has to be passed on to everyone regarding HIV and AIDS. We'll talk more about that, who is at risk, and the signs and symptoms. More on HIV-AIDS when MedTalk returns.
Did you know that you can get HIV testing in Metro Manila for free? Love Yourself, a non-government agency, provides free HIV, syphilis, and hepatitis B testing.
We're back here on MedTalk, still talking about HIV-AIDS. Doc Kate and Doc Mark, what are the symptoms of someone who is first infected with HIV? Doc Mark.
Okay, when you have HIV infection, it comes in actually three stages. So the first stage is what we call acute retroviral syndrome. It's an acute HIV infection. Once you get infected by HIV, it takes around 2 to 4 weeks before you develop these flu-like symptoms, like a simple trancaso, you know, fever, sore throat. Some may have developed rash or this enlarged or tender lymph nodes. So this is part of that infection. And after a while, it will go away. And then you go into a chronic latent stage, asymptomatic, meaning no symptoms at all. Mm-hmm. You don't know that you have the infection, but it's in there.
Okay.
And so after a while, it takes the chronic stage from studies around 6 to 8 years. After that time, it depends on the health status of the individual, of course. And after some time, when the immune system goes down, that's the time that he will go to the AIDS syndrome.
Okay.
The time then he will acquire different infections, and the symptoms in AIDS will actually depend on what kind of infections the patient will have.
Okay.
So it may be tuberculosis, meningitis, some would lose a lot of weight, some would have infections in the brain, so it actually depends. So it ranges from someone without anything, I mean not feeling anything, to the most severe cases.
Mm-hmm. So someone not feeling anything can go on with life for 10 years and not know that he has the virus?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Unless he gets tested.
And he can spread that virus without him knowing it. Well, he doesn't even know that he has the virus already.
Yes.
So is it always a correct diagnosis when one gets tested for HIV? Is it accurate all the time?
The procedure for getting oneself tested with HIV is presently two-step. First, one undergoes what we call screening using either ELISA or particle agglutination. And right now, we have something that's called the rapid test, which will yield results in less than 20 minutes.
Mm.
When someone is reactive in these screening tests, meaning the antibody to HIV is detected in that test, that same specimen then is sent for confirmation. During confirmation, it undergoes a specific test called the Western blot. This is kind of a prolonged procedure. It will take at least 2 to 4 weeks. And then after the Western blot is confirmed, now that's 99% sure that one has HIV.
Mm-hmm. Who would you recommend, or who are candidates for this type of testing, Mark?
Well, definitely those who have the risk for HIV. So this includes people who engage in sexual contact, whether it's heterosexual or homosexual, people who are engaging in intravenous drug use. But they say now even oral recreational drugs could predispose to some risky behavior,
okay?
Because you lose your the right mind if you are on recreational drugs. So you might do something that will predispose you to HIV infection.
Mm-hmm.
People who engage in sexual contact for money, so our people in prostitution, they should be also be advised to seek HIV testing.
Mm-hmm. So with all that in mind, we've also mentioned already the risk factors of someone who might be susceptible or a candidate or at risk for HIV. HIV and the connection between other transmitted diseases, because you've mentioned recreational drugs or having multiple sexual partners can also bring about other sexually transmitted diseases.
Yes.
So the connection of HIV and
to other STDs.
Yes.
So remember that HIV itself is a sexually transmitted disease. In the same concept, you can also get other STDs along with HIV or even other STDs that you have make it very easy for you to contract HIV during the next sexual encounter. This happens more so with STDs that have an ulcerative nature, meaning there is a break in your mucosa.
Okay.
Unlike other STDs like gonorrhea, in which you just have a discharge, those can predispose to HIV still, but not as much as, let's say, a chancre of syphilis.
Right. Or herpes.
Yeah, wherein the blood or sexual fluids can easily get in the other person's body.
Mm-hmm. So with these STDs, should you also be tested for the STD aside from getting your HIV?
Yes. All patients who were diagnosed with sexually transmitted infection, whether syphilis or gonorrhea, should be advised also to seek HIV testing.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the common infections that one might have?
Right.
When one has HIV? Doc Mark?
Well, it depends on what stage. So if we're going to talk about stage one, stage definitely there's asymptomatic. Mm-hmm. Then as you go on from stage two to stage three, stage four, there's a lot of infection. So in the Philippines, the most common still would be tuberculosis, whether it's pulmonary or involving other organs. And as you go on to the later stages of AIDS, you can have other infections such as cytomegalovirus infection. You can have cancer-related illnesses that is related to HIV or AIDS. And then you can also have disseminated mycobacterium avium complex or diarrhea caused by cryptosporidiosis.
So there are STDs that are connected or related to AIDS as well as other cancers.
Yes.
HIV and AIDS as well as other cancers. You know, you've mentioned different stages.
Right.
Are the different, is it when you catch it at a certain stage, what happens to the person's body? Does her, his or her entire quality of life change? Is there a cure?
So I want you to imagine the course of HIV to be like a ruler.
Okay.
Here we have when you first contracted the disease or stage one. At that moment in time, your immune system is quite robust.
Okay.
You can defend yourself from the simple infections. Then we undergo what you call the latent phase, which can last for as long as 6 to 8 years, wherein despite having the virus present in one's body, your immune system is still okay, but it slowly decreases its effectivity. When we reach a certain point wherein our immune system, which is represented by their CD4 T cells, go below a certain number, it makes you predisposed to what we call opportunistic infections.
Okay.
This means that they take advantage of an already weak immune system. So you begin to feel a lot of constitutional symptoms at first, like you often have fevers, or you often get admitted to the hospital for a sore throat or pneumonia, all sorts of stuff that normally a person without HIV can easily brush off, depending on one's immune system. That's because you are now approaching the late stage of HIV, which is AIDS.
Okay.
So a CD4 of below 200 or the presence of any of the AIDS-defining conditions will sort of classify you in that condition. The thing is, if you wait till you feel something before you get yourself tested, you would most likely not find yourself in the first part of this ruler. So it's very important that people who just think that they might be at risk just for the mere fact that I've had unprotected sex. I used oral recreational drugs in a party and I forgot what happened that night. I could have had sex, I don't know. That is one way for us to decide, okay, I think it should be my responsibility to my own self and to the people I love to have myself tested.
Yes.
It would be nice if it were done routinely, just like
how
getting
often?
Your diabetes
workup. Yeah. How often should you get?
Well, what I advise for the sexually active person is to be quarterly to do it, because the earliest time that you catch that you have the infection, then that's the best prognosis for you. That means you don't feel ill yet, your immune system is good. And then you can start medications early.
But if it is a smart virus, then with all the medications, you catch it early, it's hiding somewhere in your system, does it automatically mean that it will progress into AIDS?
Well, our goal while we need to start treatment is to control the number of virus in your body. That's that's the role of the medicine. Now, if the virus number, the viral load in the human body is controlled, it will not replicate, meaning your immune system will not be affected. So you maintain a very good immune system that's capable to fight any other infection. Now, if a patient has HIV and no treatment is done, the virus will continue to replicate. And as the virus continues to replicate, the immune system will go down, and that's the time that you will get all these infections.
So someone who's asymptomatic can go through life
without
being treated, without
but eventually it will progress.
It will progress, no?
Yeah.
What is a telltale sign that the virus has progressed, doctor? Is there a very clear-cut sign?
Well, there's a lot of infections related to the latter stages of HIV. and Mark mentioned a while ago, the disease entities that defined being in stage 3 and stage 4.
Yes.
So having, let's say, tuberculosis, although it's very endemic in the Philippines, is quite a reason now to actually just suggest an HIV test.
Mm-hmm.
When before, someone, a Filipino with TB is just, okay, it's just, you know,
my TB.
The usual Filipino.
Yes.
But now it's one of our recommendations to have TB patients tested as well for HIV.
Okay.
And like what Dr. Kate said, there are AIDS defining illnesses.
Mm-hmm.
So meaning if this patient was diagnosed with this particular condition, then it's a red flag sign now. This might be HIV related. So we advise actually testing for this patient.
Mm-hmm. Where should they go for testing?
There's a lot of places to get tested, and there are social hygiene clinics in each local government unit which provide free testing.
That's
and
nice.
There are also
private
clinics, hospitals. And treatment hubs also. We have 18 in the whole country. Yes, and they provide testing and treatment care and support for HIV.
Okay, so the hospitals and the treatment hubs and...
Yep.
And other NGOs as well. They make it their advocacy to provide a certain place for people to get tested for free.
That's nice. We've mentioned earlier during the opening that the numbers are rising and that people should get tested and they should know where to go.
Yes.
So that you catch it early on. You're able to take good care of yourself and you're able to take good care of your family in the process. Doctors will talk about, there are myths about HIV-AIDS. We'll talk about that and more about HIV-AIDS when MedTalk returns.
It was a day 34-year-old Yomi Arojado will never forget. On January 5, 2012, Yomi received a confirmatory certificate from the San Lazaro Hospital indicating that he was indeed HIV positive.
Binuksan ko, sabi ng doktor sa akin na nakasulat, sabi nakalagay doon is reactive. Di ko talaga alam kung saan ako magsisimula dahil talagang wala akong alam. Though I know for a fact na HIV and AIDS exist at that period, hindi ko alam saan ako pupunta. Ano yung next step ko?
The red flags were evident early on. Yomi was rushed to the hospital a few months prior to diagnosis because of pneumonia and tuberculosis, where it was discovered that he had a collapsed lung.
Yung mismong katawan ko is dumarating sa point na yung hingal na ako. Tapos yung ultimo yung mga katrabaho ko sa call center at that time was telling me na para daw ako naghihingalo. Hindi ko na nakayanang dumiretso sa work. So kinonta ko na yung manager ko at that time. Sabi ko hindi ako makakapag-report sa work. Ginawa ako, nag-impake na ako ng gamit ko. And at the same time, nag-prepare ako na isusugod ko na yung sarili ko sa hospital lang kasi I was living by myself.
This severely affected his work as he was forced to resign because of prolonged absences. To this day, he has no idea where he acquired this disease. Yet he remains optimistic with his partner by his side. Today, his journey continues as the executive director of Project Red Ribbon Care Management Foundation Incorporated, an HIV/AIDS advocacy group organized to help those in need.
As long as you know what to fight for, and as long as you know na tama yung sinasabi mo, and as long as you know na nakakatulong ka, nakakabigay ka ng guidance, nakakabigay ka ng yung mismong parang path para sa kanila yung tatahakin. Yun yung importante. Hindi sukatan yung sinasabi ng iba na pangit. Kumbaga maging foundation mo yung maging matatag ka. Kasi sa'yo kumukuha ng lakas ng loob yung ibang tao.
We're back here on MedTalk, still talking about HIV-AIDS. You may join in the discussion by calling our hotline at 548-4678. Doctor, it's the case of Yomi. He was rushed to the hospital because of tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. And that was what you mentioned, that sometimes if it's not diagnosed early on, there are other symptoms or signs that will give it away, so to speak. No? 2 years into 2 years, yes. He was diagnosed 2 years ago.
He was
ago.
Actually diagnosed already when he had pneumonia and tuberculosis. And when he had this condition, the doctor suspected that this might be because of another condition, like HIV. So true enough, he was diagnosed with HIV. So this is one example wherein diagnosis or testing should be done early, so that you will not be at the stage wherein you get all these infections, and treatment should be done early.
Is treatment expensive? I saw he had like a lot of medicines there in his nightstand or in his table.
Fortunately for the Philippines, the present antiretroviral regimens are free. They are a joint endeavor of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria, the Department of Health, and our own field health insurance.
Okay, so once you're tested and it is recommended that you take all these medications and treatment, that's free?
That's
free. For life.
For life.
For life, because you have the virus
for life.
Yes.
And those medications you have to take for life. Mm-hmm. Is there a certain stage where your immune system is stronger than maybe the last couple of months and you have to cut down on the medications or change your medication?
Studies have shown that stopping the medications even after your immune system has improved will resort to the virus either mutating while there is no medications and therefore getting resistant, so that when you bring back the meds that you were on, it won't work anymore. Okay. And it might lead also to a poor prognosis. So for now, the recommendation is lifetime treatment.
Right. Mm-hmm. Like we always say to patients, you know, HIV doesn't have any cure. So the only thing that you could take is these medications to control the virus. It's a lifetime condition. It's a chronic condition. We always equate it to having hypertension or diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Hypertension doesn't have any cure. Mm-hmm. Diabetes doesn't have any cure. If you have high blood pressure and you have diabetes, it's a lifetime illness. And you need to take medicines to control your blood sugar, to control your blood pressure, similar to HIV. It's a lifetime illness, and you need to take the medicine to control the virus.
How is the virus controlled? Yomi lost a lot of weight. Do you, you know, physically, are you able to engage in sports activities? Are you able to go back to work? Do you have appetite? What does the medicines or the treatment
actually, the
do?
Goal of taking the medicine is to improve the overall well-being of a patient. So once you are compliant to the medicines and your immune system has recovered from the infection, you can do anything you want.
What Mark's saying, also to add to that, is the goal of treatment is to provide viral suppression. So when someone is on antiretroviral therapy, there are a lot of tests that we do, and one of that is to improve to determine how good your immune system is, which is the CD4 T cell count, and then to determine whether the virus is still active, whether the meds are working, and that's what they call the viral load. And through these two immunologic tests, you can get a certain gauge as to, are my meds working? Will my patient have a good quality of life? Now, if you ask about how long will the medications prolong one's life, it depends. It depends on the stage that the patient was diagnosed and when the treatment was initiated.
Mm-hmm.
Fortunately, studies in developed countries have shown that if someone is diagnosed early, and that the CD4 count is still elevated, like more than 500.
What is a CD4 count? Is
that cluster differential 4 count. It represents your T cell immunity. It's the thing that the HIV attacks.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it goes down if you have HIV.
Yes.
So that's our gauge to know whether you will be started on treatment, and that is also, although not the recommended way, but it's also one way to know if your immune system has recovered from the treatment that you're receiving.
Mm-hmm.
If you started early and that your immune system is still robust, studies out from Canada and the States say that your life span at age 20 may reach the early 70s.
Nice.
But remember, that is a developed country.
Okay.
They were diagnosed earlier and they started determining lifespan at age 20. So there's a lot of factors still. We live in a developing country. We have not the best resources, and we may possibly diagnose people a lot later than earlier. But that gives us a bit of hope that the medications, although there is no cure, is serving to improve our quality of life. Mm-hmm.
We may not have a lot of resources, but we have a lot of information that can be passed on. We can educate everyone out there. Just, for example, the show is educating everyone out there on the risk factors, signs and symptoms, who's more prone, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And again, early diagnosis is key. Survival rate of those diagnosed with HIV. What is their survival rate, Doc Mark?
As long as the patient is started on antiretroviral treatment and he takes it religiously with good compliance, and he is able to maintain his CD4 level at more than 500, he could have the normal life expectancy of a non-HIV patient. So our life expectancy among Filipinos is around 60, 65.
Yes.
So an HIV patient who's taking medicines can also reach that age.
Nice.
Or more.
To enjoy his life, to enjoy family and friends, and to, like what Yomi is doing, to have an advocacy to help give information to all those out there on how to protect themselves.
Correct.
And how to be informed, you know, protection and information on this virus, this very smart virus, as you said. Myths about HIV and AIDS. Doc Mark, Doc K, myth number one: if you're receiving treatment, you can't spread the HIV virus.
If you're receiving treatment, like what was said, your goal in treatment is to suppress the replication of the virus, to get to have your virus undetectable. But it does not mean that you cannot infect someone, even if your viral load is undetectable. Remember, the viral load is tested through the blood, and that's how it is measured. But still, there are viruses in your other body fluids, like semen or vaginal fluids, which can cause infection to other people.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Myth number two: if you get HIV, you'll die soon.
I think this was prevalent in the early 80s, wherein HIV was considered a death sentence because there was no antiretrovirals available yet. Right now, we have what we call highly active antiretroviral therapy. We have modern medicine that will help us. And if diagnosed early, treated early, then this will be what it is, a myth.
Okay. Doctors, who should, before we go to myth number three, who should one consult? An infectious disease doctor
any doctor,
general practitioner
any doctor can see any patient, not necessarily an infectious disease specialist.
Okay, doctors. Next myth: you can tell if someone has HIV or AIDS by how they look. That's quite, you know what,
it's
quite judgmental.
It's judgmental.
Let's not be judgmental. It's quite a judgmental
there
myth.
There are other conditions, other illnesses, health condition that could appear like having an HIV, but it doesn't mean that you have HIV. So you cannot tell unless you get tested.
Yes, one can look very normal.
Yeah, someone who's healthy may be HIV positive, someone who's on a deathbed may not be HIV
positive. You and me and Mark can have HIV right now and no one can know about it.
Mm-hmm. Again, asymptomatic.
Yes.
You know, your immune system can be up, you're up and about. You know, you are doing the daily activities that everybody else is doing, but you are infected.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, doctors, those were all the myths that we've just debunked, so to speak. Is there any other myth that is, before we cut to a break, is there any other myth based on your practice or from your experience that you'd like to debunk regarding HIV/AIDS?
Well, for one, I guess the one myth is that HIV is only among sexual workers, commercial sex workers.
Okay.
It's not, because it can infect anyone, mm-hmm. from the professionals to the unemployed, even doctors,
right.
lawyers. We have a lot of patients employees or those who are unemployed. So anyone can get infected with
everybody
HIV.
Everybody can,
yeah. Even a baby.
Even babies.
Yes.
Even babies through blood circulation, yeah, and
mother to child transmission.
So anybody.
Through pregnancy.
So when you're pregnant, yeah, and you have the virus, it's, yeah, in your blood circulation. Yeah. And when you give birth, it's through breastfeeding. Is that correct?
Even during delivery,
The child can get infected. That's why they're now recommending a C-section. And then breastfeeding can also be a mode of transmission.
But the good thing about it is because of the medications,
yes,
an HIV reactive mother can give birth to an HIV negative baby.
Yes.
Oh, how nice.
Yes.
As long as the mom is on treatment, on medicines.
Okay.
Because if the mom is not taking any medicine, the chances of transmitting the virus to the baby is around 20% to 40%. If the mom is on the antiretroviral treatment, it can go down to as low as 1% to 2%. Mm-hmm. There's still risk.
Yes, there's still a risk there.
Early detection is still the key. Mm-hmm,
because once you have the virus, it's with you for life.
Yes.
Yes.
And even a baby will carry that virus with him or with her.
As he grows up.
Doctors, we'll talk more about HIV/AIDS when MedTalk returns.
Did you know that more than 1,000 Filipino youth aged 15 to 24 years old were recorded as HIV positive in the first 8 months of 2014? In fact, 146 cases of HIV in the same age group were identified by the Department of Health.
Back here on MedTalk, still talking about HIV/AIDS. Doctors, I understand the WHO has 5 C's when they do the testing. Please tell us about that, Doc Mark.
Okay, it's a recommendation for all patients who seek testing, HIV testing, and it is mandated by the WHO that we should follow the 5 C's. So number one is consent. You cannot seek testing, you cannot be pushed, or you cannot be required to seek testing. It's voluntary. And it's on your own volition. And then there should be confidentiality. Okay, so like any other test, like any other condition, there should be only the patient should be aware of the diagnosis, and no one can tell the results of the test to anyone without the consent of that particular patient. And then the third one would be counseling. It is recommended that counseling should be done prior to testing and after testing, regardless of the results. So that includes also advice on sexual health care and what to do next if the test turns out to be positive or negative. And then the fourth one would be
correct
results. What Dr. Kate said, HIV testing undergoes a certain process, certain protocol. It is just not one simple test. There's screening and there is confirmatory. So before we actually inform the patient of the result, it should be verified by either a screening or a confirmatory testing. And then the one would be linkage to care. So once the patient turns out to be HIV negative, there should be a connection, a network of care, and that would be a referral to other hospitals or treatment hubs for continuation of care.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Mark. This time, Doc Mark, Doc K, we have a caller on the line. You're Katokayo, Doc Mark. Hi, Mark. Good evening.
Hi. Good evening.
Hi.
Hi, Mark.
Please go ahead with your question. Hi.
Hi, yes. I'm actually diagnosed last year, early quarter, for this disease. And I'm actually doing my research as well, definitely, and I'm looking into the available meds from other countries kasi medyo parang there are at least more than 20 na. So is there a better medicine from the other?
Okay. Doc K or Doc Mark?
Right now, we have the medications that are given for free by the Global Fund. And although these are limited medications, they have been seen to work by causing viral suppression in the patients who take them. Of course, the medications available abroad are more up-to-date, more modern, but we have to remember that we have to think about the cost efficiency of having such expensive meds here and providing them for everyone equally. So as long as we achieve viral suppression with the available free meds, I think that is something good. But if you have an option to get the better medications and you can procure them,
then
that will be your privilege. Mm-hmm. You're right.
All right. Okay. So my next question is, I have a second question, is that right?
Sorry.
Hello?
Yes, Mark. Kindly repeat.
Yeah. I have a second question. Is that all right?
Yes. Please go ahead.
Okay. Kasi nung nagpa-test ako, it was rapid test lang yung ginamit. And I haven't heard about what happened on the during the confirmatory test when it was forwarded to San Lazaro. So to me, mababa yung CD4 count when I was diagnosed with the rapid test na. So they sent me to the steps, may mga steps na sinabi doon, but I never heard about the confirmatory, kung ano ba talaga, but is it a good base na to parang rely on yung rapid test mismo once it turns out reactive?
Okay, what happened in your case is actually, so you got tested with a rapid kit, and then all blood tests, all over the country, all tests, all blood samples that turned out to be positive during the screening will be sent to San Lazaro, the STD-AIDS Central Cooperative Laboratory, or SACL, and they will be the ones to do the confirmatory. Now, the process should have been the SACL will submit the results of that particular test to that center where you had the rapid kit, the rapid testing. And it depends on the treatment hub that you are seeing, whether the treatment, the antiretroviral treatment will be started or not, pending the results of your confirmatory.
Okay, but has there been instances na positive yung rapid test, but negative when it was in the confirmatory?
Yes, there are cases and there are instances where in the confirmatory turns out to be negative. Because in the confirmatory, there are particular bands, number of bands that they will be looking at. And if the number of bands do not satisfy a conclusive result, they will report it as negative. But if that happens, you will be asked to have a repeat testing done. And that's also a CDC, a Center for Disease Control recommendation, to have a repeat testing done.
Okay. One last question. Is it okay?
Okay, go ahead, Mark.
Yeah. Alam, nakalimutan ko, wait lang. Kasi, I was consulting kasi with the viral load, di ba, kinukuha siya after the 1 year from the diagnosis. And I understand that medyo iba-iba kasi I consulted different doctors. And right now, I think yung most reliable answer na nakuha ko was the least number of copies of viral count per millimeter of blood using ELISA is less than 40 copies. Is that the maximum that this machine can check?
Okay. So or Mark, you're talking about the viral load results, am I right?
Yes, no.
Okay. So the viral load result will differ per machine. So there are machines which have a higher threshold of detection, and that will be the basis why they will say, for example, let's say you're undetectable. They will always say that your viral load is less than, let's say, 7 or 20 or 47. That specific number is machine dependent. So if you have a state-of-the-art machine, it will say, I cannot detect any virus below 7. That means, ang ganda, ang baba ng threshold. Pero kung medyo mataas, machine dependent siya. Pero technically, if they say that it's below a certain number, then it's undetectable.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
That will be it, Doc. Thank you very much for the answers.
Thank you for calling, Mark. Take care.
Yeah, thank you.
Good night. You're welcome. doctor's final message already. Before that, information to all our viewers out there, the ABCs of HIV-AIDS prevention.
Yes, we followed this ABCDE of HIV prevention. So A actually stands for abstinence, so no sex, don't engage in sexual contact. That's the one way that you can prevent HIV from getting to your body. Because you get it from sex, so don't engage in sexual contact, and that's one way to prevent HIV. And then if you cannot help but engage in sexual contact, just be faithful.
Okay.
Be loyal.
If you can't do letter A, go to letter B.
Go to letter B.
Okay.
Monogamous, whether heterosexual or homosexual relationship, is one way to prevent HIV. And then after B, if you really cannot you can follow letter B, go to C, use condoms.
Okay.
So condom use, is one good way to prevent getting sexually transmitted infections, particularly HIV.
100%? 80%?
80%, but compared to none, it's still
okay.
Better
it is
to
a
use
big number.
Protection.
All right,
and
letter D.
D is do not engage, do not use drugs. Do not do drugs, whether it's intravenous drugs or oral recreational drugs. Do not do drugs because, like what you said, if you engage in these recreational drugs,
you don't know what
you don't know what
you
you're
know
doing.
When you wake up the next morning, you don't know what happened.
Yes.
Okay.
And last and most important actually is education and information. Be educated, be aware, be smart, know your status.
Should outsmart that smart virus.
You're smarter than that virus.
You were smarter than that virus. You know, we're smarter. Early diagnosis, information, education. Final message or tip? Let's start with you, Doc K.
Okay. December 1 is World AIDS Day. Let's not wait for this day to have ourselves tested. Every day is an opportunity to know what our status is. It's our responsibility to our loved ones, to ourselves, to our own health. And the earlier that you know about your status, the better outcome for the HIV-positive person.
Thank you very much, Doc K. Doc Mark?
HIV is in the country, and it's affecting everyone from all walks of life, different ages. And one thing that we should remember with HIV is that we should be aware of this kind of infection. And for those people with living with HIV, they just need some understanding and compassion. They're also human beings. They just that they have this chronic infection, and society should understand their condition.
Mm-hmm. Society should understand and not judge.
Yes.
Okay, so thank you once again, Doc K. Doc Mark, we'd also like to thank Mark, our caller. We'll see you again next Tuesday, 7 p.m. here on MedTalk, your scheduled on-air consultation on 9TV. This is Angel Jacob. Good night, everyone.